I'm Chris Breen from Macworld. I am sitting with Dr. Bill Wiecking from Hawaii Preparatory Academy. We're going to talk about Mac in education, green technology, some of the work that Bill's doing in Hawaii. And have any of you heard the podcast where Bill was on as a guest? Yes. Okay, well, so let's do a kind of a recap of what we talked about.
Sure. That was a fun hour. We talked about green technology, but also sustainability, education. If you're a parent or a teacher, you are an educator, and you're dealing with kids. And so we are trying to figure out how to best implement technology to help the learning process instead of making the learning process fit the technology. We wanted to turn that around. And I issued sort of a challenge to educators that they needed to up their game a little bit. I think that's fair to say. And I'm an educator, been an educator a long time, so I know what I'm talking about, I think. But I really wanted to remove the excuses that technology can be in the way of education, and it can be an enabler. That's where we started, I think.
Okay. Let's talk a little bit about the Energy Lab and the work you've done. So the Energy Lab is on the Big Island of Hawaii.
It is. That's the one with the active volcanoes. And what we've done is we've developed a lab that's about 6,000 square feet, about three times the normal size of a home. It's completely zero energy, zero water, zero waste. It's a prototype. It's not a cheap building, but it demonstrates several things about education that you can learn using cutting edge technologies. We have a lot of iPads and a lot of laptops. Oddly, no desktop computers, but in order to keep the energy numbers very low, we have a very sustainable passive lighting, passive ventilation system. And it really acts as a model for kids about what a healthy classroom could be if you really took it to the next level. So that's what we've tried to do. So we're modeling best behavior or best practices with the best equipment, which is some of this stuff.
Yeah, now I thought it was interesting that there's a lot of Apple technology in this building. I mean, you look at this and it's a very interesting looking building, a lot of windows,
right.
A lot of light, but you took me downstairs, I think, into sort of the guts of the thing.
Right.
And I was expecting big, you know, Mac Pros,
right.
And X Serves, and maybe some Unix boxes.
Right.
And instead, I saw some Mac Minis.
Right. We use Mac Minis because they're very good on energy. And energy where we are is about 45 cents a kilowatt hour. I don't know what it is where you guys are, but it's probably 9 or 10 times cheaper than that. And so energy is a big deal for us, not just because of the expense, but also because we're trying to model best behavior on how we use energy and resources. So part of this is technical and part of this is social. We're trying to educate our kids that you can't just walk out and leave the water running or the lights on. So what we've tried to do is wherever possible, we use X Serves only for off-site backup where they're needed, but we use Minis for almost everything. And we're replacing some of the Minis we had the first time because they're 12 watts and the new ones are 8 watts.
Right.
And that extra 4 watts, if you multiply it by 5 or 10 machines, really adds up after a time.
Yeah. Now, one of the interesting things I thought when I came into the Energy Lab, which is also a working classroom.
It is.
It's not just an experiment. I mean, you actually teach kids here.
Yeah, I could actually go a little bit better than that. It's not even a classroom. If you bring a traditional teacher into this building and they look for where do I sit or where's my desk, there is no place for that. It makes them a little bit uncomfortable because it's not set up like a normal classroom. It's really a collection of rooms, large rooms and small rooms, with mobile computing resources. So when kids come in, the first thing they do is grab an iPad and go wherever they want. So if you ask any teacher, where's my class? They'll say, well, 2 of them are over there, and 6 are over there, and 5 are over there. And that's the way I want it. I want it to be a sort of a comfortable, flexible learning environment for the kids.
Now, and that works counter to everything that I've sort of thought about school. I mean, I'm a father coming late to the game.
Right.
And so when I saw other parents bringing up their kids, and I go visit classrooms, I think, okay, each classroom has 3 or 4 computers, and then they have a computer lab where the kids
right.
go a couple of times a week. And I think I was looking at my school, and I emailed you, and I said, okay, well, what should I expect from my school's computer lab, and what can I do to help out?
Right.
And essentially, you just said, don't.
Don't. Yeah.
And that was shocking to me that it isn't that model anymore. So what is the model?
Yeah, well, the old model of education was you went to a computer lab and you sat at a fixed station and there was a keyboard that you dare not move more than 6 inches from side to side, maybe a mouse, depends on your era. And that was where you did your computing. So your learning had to fit the technology instead of the other way around. In our situation, this is the first one to go because the kids can take it anywhere and then the laptops go. And there is no fixed computer lab or computer place where the people will sit. So what it really does is it takes that whole paradigm of meeting the technology where it is and flips it upside down. One fun example about that is that over the weekend, we were missing one of our iPads. So I thought, could it have been stolen? I'm not sure. So I went around to the pile of the iPads and I turned them all off, and then I went on .me. And I said, find my iPad. And it was in the building. Someone had hidden it because they didn't want to be without it. So they don't want to get there and find out they're all gone, so they hid it in a closet someplace, we're not sure where, because it just mysteriously showed up the next day. But these are very, very popular. And the thing is that the kids get this. We don't have to teach them at all.
Right.
So if you're a person who's educating people or buying technology for education, you really need to reassess the whole computer lab paradigm. It's not practical anymore. And the devices themselves, I mean, if you look at pinch and zoom on this, the fact that you can do this, and the fact that you can move this around, it changes the entire educational experience for us. The metaphor I like to use when I'm showing this to people, and it's kind of funny, when people come through the lab, even if they've never seen this before, they take it and they do this. And then they open it up and I say, push the button. And they say, oh, okay. And that's the end of the training. That's it. After that, I say, turn on the, push the little purple icon, which is Star Walk. You guys ever seen Star Walk before? It's an astronomy application. And I say, they look at it and they see all the stars. And I say, okay, now lift it up to the sky, and they all go like this. And what's funny is you have a collective ooh, because they realize that instead of being strapped into a chair and looking out the porthole of a ship and seeing what the ship goes by, you now have the porthole in your hands and you can move this around where you like. What's interesting though is that the adults all go like this, the kids do that, and then they go like this, and they look at the stars that are gonna show up tonight. And that's an out of the box thinking process. I didn't teach them, they just do it naturally. So what's fun is, as a teacher, this thing enables me to see how the mind of the kids work instead of me forcing them to fit my paradigm. And, you know, we're not 29 anymore, right?
I am.
Oh, you are, okay.
Yeah.
Again.
Still.
So the education paradigm that we were raised with is something we're trying to break. And it's not easy, but our job as educators is to be able to look over the corner and predict, prepare our kids for a world that doesn't exist yet, and for jobs that don't exist yet, and using technology that doesn't exist yet. And the best that we can do is that this is the flexible platform for education and not the laptop. As a matter of fact, our textbooks are all on these now. So whether they're scanned or purchased, this is what the kids prefer to read their textbooks on, because you can zoom in and you can see the words and the pictures. On a laptop, they don't even have that. So imagine where we are with this, that a laptop is now old technology. It's crazy. So I have a 6-year-old at home, he loves this. If this isn't available, well, he'll grab my phone. But the laptop is the last resort. And he said the other day he saw a phone that was plugged into the wall, and he said, is that a fax machine, Dad? Because for him, he'd only seen a phone that was wired to the wall if it had a fax machine attached to it. So we're trying to prepare kids for a new paradigm where this will, quite frankly, be old. This will be the first generation. Just like the first iPod Shuffle you look at, or right. the first iPod, and you say, why are you spinning that wheel around?
Yeah.
Exactly. How quaint.
Well, I think, playing devil's advocate, I think that some educators and some parents might say, well, look, you're at a very nice private school. You've got kids with money. You've got money coming into
parents
the place.
Parents with money.
Parents with money, right. And, you know, you can afford to do this. And where you look at public schools now, certainly
right.
in my state, here in California and probably all over the country,
yeah.
public schools are cutting back. And, you know, they would probably turn to you and say, well, look, I can't outfit a classroom with iPads. I don't know how to do this. But at the same time, these are the same people that are saying, check your iPhones, check your Android, check your phone at the
yeah.
door, because I don't want that in my classroom.
There are two parts to this. I'll answer the last one first,
okay.
And that is that a friend of mine told me this. He said, if you're a teacher and you insist on not in bringing this technology in because you're afraid it's going to disrupt your learning, it should disrupt your learning. You're teaching wrong if you're afraid of this. So he's really laying down the gauntlet that we need to challenge the way that we teach. And I thought that was fairly wise. The other thing I would say about buying infrastructure is the big problem about a computer lab, if you've ever been in one, is watch it all day and all night and see how often it's used. A large percentage of the time it's sitting there with empty chairs. That's money you're paying for. You're paying for electricity, you're paying for support, you're paying for an internet connection. All of these resources are just basically going out the window. With something like this, it's used by all the different classes. So at any one time, you can come in my lab, which I don't know how many classes can fit in there, but it can host 300 or 400 people in different spaces. And I think yesterday afternoon we had an English literature class that's studying the ecology of sustainability, a green technology class doing sustainable engineering, AP environmental science, robotics class, a yoga class outside, and an art class. It's a pretty wide area. And it's not like one class came in and poached all the iPads. It's a very fluid sort of environment. It's a lot like the one-room schoolhouse metaphor, where you have a lot of different people in the room. The other thing that's interesting is that last semester we hosted 25 people from Stanford. Mm. Now, being a Cal graduate, I had to sort of dissuade them from showing everybody their tail. But the funny thing was that our kids, kindergartners, first graders, juniors, seniors, were interacting with these college students, and it was completely fluid. Their professors were there, their graduate advisors were there, the college students were there, my first grader was there, and there was no balkanization or foxholing. It was all very fluid situation. So that's not a technical thing, but it's a social thing that demonstrates that as fluid as the environment is in the learning space that I am lucky enough to work in, the technology is another aspect of that. It's very fluid, it's not rigid, we don't fit people into certain rooms. So when if you were a student, say you're a teacher, yeah, and you wanted to reserve, you were a teacher.
I was, yeah.
There you go. So if you were a teacher and you came in and you said, I'd like to reserve the lab, you wouldn't have to reserve a room, you just say, I want to be there. Mm-hmm. And then we'd figure out where that fits.
Right.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, absolutely.
So there's a facilities thing, but there's also keeping it out of the classroom thing.
Right. Well, I thought there was an interesting reaction to that podcast that we did, because you challenged educators, say, I want to hear from you. What do you think? I heard from some, and some of the reaction was absolutely positive. Said, yes, we should be doing this.
Right.
Instead of checking your technology at the door, you have a conversation with your students and agree, no angry birds, no
doodle jump,
no texting, no doodle jump. But you can use this because this is your window to the world and to the internet.
It is. It should be, because we're training these kids to use this as a window to the world. Why should that stop at the door? So if you insist on using a textbook, which I use textbooks, I love books, but I've scanned a lot of stuff, and my typical lesson plan is something that's on a weblog. So the kids will come in, they've read the weblog, they've checked it the night before, they know what they're supposed to read. If I find anything on the web that I think is interesting, I'll include that on the weblog, no later than, say, 8 o'clock at night, so they have a chance to read some small articles. They'll come in the next day, they know exactly what's going to be there. They all open up the laptops, the weblog's on there, the readings for the day, the lesson plans, the tests if they need them, and it's all here. And we have textbooks and we have reading materials that are on here, but there's a fluidity to it. It's not a sort of a, now we're going to pick these up, or now we're going to go visit the lab. It's a very much a fluid sort of a situation.
Yeah, now, but as you as instructor, how do you vet what the kids see on the internet? And I don't mean seeing porn or something like that, but rather, how do you direct them to information that's verifiable?
Right.
Because so many kids nowadays, if they have to write a paper, they go to Wikipedia.
Right.
Just like we used to go to the encyclopedia, and go, nah, 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 and scribble it down and change three words and say, there.
You did that too?
Of course. Well, that I changed five words because I was a better student.
You were an A student.
I was an A student. So, but how do, with all that information out there, how do you vet them, and how do you teach them that this isn't just the encyclopedia?
It's not how do I, it's that I must, because they go home and there's this virtual toilet out there where they can get access to everything. When you and I were younger, there was the Encyclopedia Britannica, and if there was a misspelled word or a bad, a wrong fact in there, it was news.
Yeah.
And now there's Twitter, which is the other end of the spectrum, and it's like completely vacuous, useless stuff, and the web is everywhere in between. So our job as educators is to help them be critical thinkers and critical learners and to use that space. As a classroom teacher, I can tell when a student is on this and they're using Angry Birds because it moves around. or you hear the zip or doodle jump. Now, there are some teachers that use this, they use laptops with Apple Remote Desktop, which was an excuse to spy on people. And they would sit there like, some Gestapo guy looking at all the screens going, oh, you're browsing something that you're not supposed to be on. Who has time for that? But also, it changes your frame of mind if you're dealing with the kids, if you're always a policeman. And I don't like to do that. What I can tell you is that with these iPads, and I'm not selling these things, by the way, with these iPads, there are a couple of social things that you may not have assumed or may not have realized. Number one, if you're in a meeting and someone's typing on a laptop, it's rude because they're looking at your forehead or the top of your head because there's this wall. With these, there's not. So typically, in a classroom situation, people tend not to be on Facebook because they know that I can see over the top of it. The other thing is, since multitasking is not something that's very common on these, it can be done, but it's not common, they tend to be on task. If you look at a laptop, if you walk around and if you're very quick, you'll see that they've got what they want here and their Facebook is right over here. And they're really good at switching it over. And I don't know if you guys know what POS stands for in IM. You guys know what that means? POS, parent over shoulder. It means don't type anything next, right? So with these, the things we notice is there's a much more open interaction. They don't tend to be in their own little world like this. They tend to be a lot more open. They tend to actually leave it on the table. The other thing is that if you're in a meeting, especially a quiet meeting, and someone's typing with their laptop, I find that really rude because they're supposed to be listening to you and they can't be doing that and doing this. And with this, if they're typing or if they're doing anything, it's silent. So it's not as intrusive or invasive. I know these are silly sort of social things, but they're things that I pick up as a classroom teacher. This is less of an invasive thing than the laptop. Given a choice between the two, I would rather have a lot of these than a lot of the laptops.
Right.
Did I answer the question?
No, that's okay.
okay.
But it prompts another one.
Okay.
Social networking. Is there a place for social networking in education?
Gosh, I don't know. I can tell you that, how many of you guys have kids? Yeah? Have you ever seen your kids do homework?
You should.
You should. There are 9 or 15 Facebook or iChat conversations going on while their homework's over here. And they're asking everybody how to answer the things. Present students, past students, future students. It's an entire web. It's like talking to a beehive. You're not talking to one bee. You're talking to the collective, maybe it's a Borg, I don't know.
Yeah.
But they're talking to this collective intelligence. And when they're going through a question, they're networking. But then when they get into class, that entire networking and communication scheme ceases, or it's supposed to. And I'm not quite sure how to answer that, whether it's proper or not. I find it difficult because it's difficult for me to sort of keep them on task if they're interacting with each other. But
right.
What I've found successful is to break the class time into, my attention span's about 12 minutes. My kids are about 9. So happy medium, about 10 minutes. If you're not doing something different every 10 minutes in a classroom, you're wasting your time. So I'll talk for 10 minutes and then I'll say, now I want you guys to do something. Then the networking starts up and they're either doing it in person or on this or whatever. And then 10 minutes later, I'll start up again and I'll go over some stuff. 10 minutes later, we go back and forth. And that's the most successful I've found, really.
Yeah.
But as far as the social networking in the classroom, I'd have to say that when it's not directed, and this is so new that the kids don't know the etiquette with this, they don't know what's rude and what's not. It's like we wouldn't eat while we're talking to somebody usually, but kids will pick up the phone and do this while they're talking to you. And they don't know that that's not really very good manners. Likewise with computer use, the whole ethos of what's good manners, what's good etiquette hasn't been established yet. However, we're the ones who are gonna model that because they're not gonna learn it out in the street. They're going to learn it in the classroom where there's someone saying, look, that's just not the okay way to use that. You need to be respectful of the people around you.
Well, I mean, the one area where I wonder about social networking, and as you described it, working on homework, it is collaborative learning in a way. I mean, they're swapping information back together, so it's more of a hive thing.
Yeah.
But I don't know, you know, in the classroom, certainly it's disruptive, but does it train you in some way that you're doing groupthink and you arrive at a conclusion that way, or is it just simply we're playing around?
Yeah, really good question. Excellent question. I guess the metaphor I think of is it's like education up till now has been these sailing ships, right? Like Columbus's Nina, Pinta, and Santa Maria. And right now we're dragging them behind the Queen Elizabeth, right, with big ropes. And they still have their sails up and they're like blowing all over the place and they're going way faster than they were ever designed to do. And that's what we're trying to do, is we're dragging these old ships behind. What we really need to do is redesign the ships. So we need to be in faster ships. So a lot of the problem that we have with this is that we are insisting that testing be solo, because it's the way we were raised.
Right.
It's the only thing we know.
Yep.
Testing could be collaborative or it could be essay-based, which means, Chris, go talk to your friends and come up with a solution for this. And then come back and we're gonna ask you your input about what you learned with that.
Mm-hmm.
We're not gonna ask you when Columbus landed. We're gonna ask you to describe in a broader picture, what were the implications of that? Who was here when he landed? Was it alone? I mean, were there people here? That
right.
kind of stuff. So less just rote memorization of facts and more synthesis of information, which is quite frankly what we're trying to prepare our kids for. Because in the world of Wikipedia and the web, the recall of facts is not not important, but it's less important because they can access the facts. I think they do need to know that he landed in 1492 and that that's before the Civil War.
Right.
A lot of my kids don't know that. But I have to tell you that having the sense of context and how we test and what we test for is about to go through a paradigm shift because we're dragging the sailing ship behind us, and that's the old testing method.
Right.
It's also the old studying method. It's the old homework method. It's the old textbook method. It's the old reading method. A lot of things are going to have to change with the way society is going to demand certain things from these people. And it's not going to be recall of facts. It's going to be how well can you work in a group? Can you communicate? Can you collaborate? Can you express yourself? Can you think clearly? Can you do critical thinking and determine the wheat from the chaff? These are all way, way more important or harder to teach, really. It's a challenge, again. Here I am again, challenging teachers.
Well, I mean, take the simple example of you're in a math class, and they say, no, you actually have to work everything out on paper. Or in the old days, yes, you can have a slide rule, but you can't have a calculator. And, yeah. And when I go into the real world, I am going to have a calculator. So, yes, I need to understand how the widget goes together.
Yeah, that's
but
true.
Do I need to jump through these hoops when I do have technology, such as Wikipedia, such as the web, where I don't have to memorize this stuff because I don't need it anymore?
Yeah, but one of the ways that we teach critical thinking is if you're going to teach, say, how to do a parabola, you first do it the hard way, not just because, well, we did it our way, you know, when we walked uphill both ways, broken glass, bare feet to school, but they have to understand where the process, how the process evolved. And that's how they get their sense of context, because as educators, we're no longer trying to give people facts, we're trying to give them context.
Right.
It's kind of like the big problem now with publishers are about to be, here's another metaphor for you. Publishers are watching the lion going around. The lion just ate all the gazelles. And the publishers are kind of like these, you know, antelope. They're saying, wow, look what happened to all the gazelles. I wonder what's going to happen next. And that was the gazelles were the music industry. And the publishing industry has to realize that their gift is not just in delivering paper. It's in really being critical editors, content filters. You can put out a science book, but if you say there's an atmosphere on the moon, you've got a problem, right? You put out bad music, no one's just going to listen to it. But what I think is really important as teachers is we have to get past the idea that we're just conveying facts and we're giving context.
Right.
And that's our unique gift. Also, a thing that's very, very hard to get, and I've hired a lot of teachers, and that is you can find people that have the knowledge and they might be able to give context, but they have no passion for the kids. And if they don't have that last one, then the first two are useless.
Right.
You're a musician, talented musician. You can nod, yeah?
Yes, I am.
Very talented musician. And you can tell when Chris plays because he enjoys what he's doing and it's different every time. And if you watch a good teacher, you'll find that they enjoy what they're doing and it's different every time. And if it isn't different every time, then they're not teaching.
Right.
They're reciting.
Right.
And that's another challenge I think that we really need to do is this fits into this whole technology thing with education is that if you're not open to the new things, that's like you saying, I'm only going to play on the harpsichord. Harpsichord is what I learned on.
Yeah.
Well, there's this pianoforte thing. Yeah, but I learned on the harpsichord. Sorry, all my music's going to be on the harpsichord. You're limiting yourself, right?
Yes.
So as a teacher, if I say I'm not going to use the iPad because I learned on the harpsichord, you get the mixed metaphor.
Right. So looking at where we are and where we're going, what could Apple do to make your job easier?
Should I cover up my little visitor badge?
You can turn that around.
I was at Apple this morning. One of the things that I think that Apple could do is really reinvigorate the old ADE, Apple Distinguished Educator thing, and the Apple Learning Exchange. I think iTunes U is a fantastic thing. Have you guys ever seen iTunes U? Awesome, right? I mean, it doesn't mean that you can, there are some people that say, if I have Wikipedia and iTunes U, why should I pay for a four-year college? Well, you pay for a four-year college because the education in college isn't the other teachers that you meet. It's a very small fraction of that. I went to Berkeley, and I tell you that the gross part of my education was the other people in the classroom that asked the tough questions and that make me work harder. The teachers were very, very smart, obviously, but 7 Nobel Prize teachers, I mean, where do you get that, right?
Yeah.
There are Nobel Prize parking spaces at Cal. That's just craziness. But the thing is that if you go into any classroom, you're going to find that that's where the education takes place, is between you and the other students, that synthesis. So I really, really think that we need to work on that as much more of an issue. I'm straying from the subject again. But I think what Apple really can do is focus on how do we enable the teachers and become less afraid of this. That's, I think, the biggest hurdle. Ask any teacher who the smartest kid in technology is, or the smartest person in technology in the room is, and 9 times out of 10 they aren't going to say themselves. They're going to say, oh, that's George over there, or Louise, she knows how to do that, just ask her. Well, it's wonderful that they know who the resource is. That's an enlightened teacher. The non-enlightened teacher will say, don't ask me that question. They're afraid. So what we really have to do is we have to get the teachers to get past that technical hurdle.
And that's what I really challenged them to in the podcast. I said, you know, if you haven't had a chance to listen to that, Chris and I had a really neat exchange about what could we do, not if we were like emperors of the world, but if we really had a vision for how we could change education. And it has to start with the teachers, because they have to be not afraid of this first, and then they can make their own enlightened decision about how they're going to use the technology. So I think Apple could really help with that. I think iTunes U is great. It enables people who are, put yourself in the position of a really eager student who's got a really bad teacher, or a teacher who's saying, no, you're not going to use that. You can go home if you've got web access, or if you don't, go to the library, and go on iTunes U, and you can watch any lecture from some very good schools. That's a tremendous resource. And I have to tell you, when we were young, we didn't have that.
Right.
I mean, look at what our kids, we both have young kids, look at our kids' environment, what they're going to grow up with. They're going to be able to say, I'm interested in simple harmonic motion. Well, I'll go to MIT and have that guy swinging back and forth on the bowling ball, if you guys have ever seen that video. The guy is the bowling ball, right? It's the teacher swings back and forth. It's an awesome video. I mean, we can't deliver that in a classroom.
No. Well, okay, and speaking of our kids, because we'll get personal for a minute.
Yes, we will. You got pictures?
I do. I won't show them to the web. But shortly after my visit to Hawaii,
right.
Again, the new school year starts, and my daughter uses the computer some. She uses the iPad a lot.
Right.
But I said, okay, we really need to work on her typing skills, because they don't do that so much in school anymore. And so I said, so what do you guys use for a typing program, and what should I do there, and how much should I get her involved in Keynote versus PowerPoint?
Right.
And once again, you sort of said...
Yeah, I sidestepped the question, which is usual for me. You don't... And what was our discussion? It was about chat.
Yeah.
Because one of my older kids is dyslexic, and he hated typing. He was forced to do it in say, 6th grade, 7th grade, hated typing. And then IM surfaced. All of a sudden, he's typing all the time. His typing went from here to here, and now he's applying for medical school. It's like, where did that come from?
Yeah.
I mean, if it's motivating, I think that they will do it. But when you and I were taught keyboarding, it was on a manual typewriter. You know, well, let's not date ourselves too much, but it was sit here and type random letters. It wasn't typing to your friends as fast as you could,
yeah.
And it wasn't typing to 9 friends as fast as you could. Because the funny thing is about IM is that people can tell when you're a crappy typist because of all the misspelled words. There's no spell check on that, right? So you're motivated to kind of make yourself look a little bit better. Interesting side story on that is that back in 94, 95, I was teaching and the web was coming out. We were doing a lot of cool things. And as a science teacher, I decided to have all my kids do their lab reports as web pages. And what I noticed was instead of this piece of paper that was misspelled and everything else, number one, they knew their friends were going to look at it. Other people were going to look at it. They took care to make sure that, number one, it was typed. It looked nice. It made sense. It wasn't copied from somebody else. And they put graphics and all kinds of cool stuff in there. And they really took care with it because other people were going to see it instead of just me. And I think that's what IM really does, is that their friends, their peers know that they are typing slowly or poorly. Mm-hmm. And so they get better by peer pressure.
Yeah, and it turned out it worked. In my case, I didn't set her up with IM because I'm not quite ready for that yet. But I did get her an email account.
Right.
And I turned on parental controls and I said, okay, you can talk to me and mom and your grandmother and these friends. And it just happened very, very quickly. I mean,
right.
At the end of the day, she has her little time on the computer. She gets on her email. The first thing she did was figure out, I want to change colors in the type.
Right.
I want to type in pink. And I said, well, okay, that's not good web design, but sure, if it's more fun for you, do it. And then she said, well, how do I copy these icons? So that was the avenue, not only for trying to type better, but also exploring the interface, because I want to do cool stuff with this so I can show Grammy this thing that she can't do.
And she owned the experience, right?
And she totally owned the experience.
Yeah.
And then my mother could then type back to her and say, how do you do that? And then she's the teacher.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, that is just one of those technology moments when you go, this is so great.
It really is. And the other thing that a lot of my students are asking, I want to do iPad apps or I want to do iPhone apps because they think they're so easy. Well, they're intuitive looking, but there's a lot of thought that goes behind that. It's deceptively simple. And I loved your story about how you said your daughter wanted to learn to do an iPad app and you turned on Page Source and you showed her what HTML looks like and she went, eek, all of that stuff.
Right.
But what was your solution ultimately?
Well, the solution for that, instead of, you know, first you scare her, you know, so she won't go, ugh. And then I got her a book, which is called Hello World, and it's easy Python stuff. And we did a little of that, you know, so she could go into Terminal, type a few commands, and something would happen on the computer, and she'd go, oh, that's cool. But the real solution is Lego Mindstorms. Got that for her, and once you do that, then you've got, you build these little robots, which are cool, and they show you, you know, big pictures, put this here, and together, the two of us fashion this thing. And then they've got this graphic user interface. And what you're demonstrating to them is that programming is simply taking a series of actions and steps, and every so often you split, if this happens, then do this. If this happens, do this. So you create conditionals. And it's so graphically oriented and so results driven when you piece together six things, and all we did was the robot said hello, it went 9 rotations, it turned left, it screamed, it backed up, it turned around and came back to the point of where it started, and then it said goodbye and it turned itself off. And that was, you know, was like the blink moment for her, and it's like, I programmed something. And not only is there the pride of coming with it and it's fun, but then you're starting to instill the concept of this is what basically programming is.
Right.
And then after you go beyond that, then you say, okay, all they're doing with all this text is basically what's in the GUI. And then, so if you want to take the step inward, the next step in is learning those commands that make it do this, that connects to this, and off you go.
So you did basically what you just asked me about typing, which is get it into something that's comfortable, fun, engaging, instead of rote typing of letters.
Yeah.
And what's funny is that if you look at how computer programming still is taught in universities, they force you to take math and logic courses to realize, well, this is A and B and blah, blah, blah. And what happens is we wind up turning off very talented, very inspired programmers because they don't want to go through all of the heavy lifting and everything. When I was at Cal in 76 to 80, they were writing Unix. So when you start up your Mac and it says, if you ever start up in single user mode and you see the white letters and it says, copyright 1981, the University of California, that was taught in the math building over at Berkeley at Evans Hall in the basement. I was there when they were doing it. And it was like, what are you math guys doing? Oh, we're working on a very complex program and we're adapting AT&T Unix. Oh, cool. Can I watch? Yeah, cool. So I watched them do this. They were all math guys who then turned into computer guys. So in your case, Adelaide hasn't taken algebra, right?
No.
No math.
No math.
But she knows how to program.
Right.
That's where I think programming is gonna probably wind up being, is it's gonna start with GUIs and people are gonna understand how it works, get motivated, and then they'll go back and they'll learn the logic that they need to.
Exactly. So I was wondering if any of you had questions. We can have somebody come through a microphone and ask you questions.
Jim, right away.
Hang on a second. We're just gonna find a mobile mic. And here comes, this is Jim Hopkins, who has sort of done all this. He's godlike. And we have a question over here.
Yes, I had a question for school districts. How can you persuade school districts, which control everything, about trying to, you know, implement this sort of means of restructuring of the classroom and the control? Because it's easy enough in a private school, but in public schools, there's a little bit more, you know, hierarchy and bureaucracy, and it's hard to sort of be more innovative in that structure.
Yeah, very good question. Very good question.
Go Bears.
Yeah. Thanks. I knew there had to be somebody in the audience. I'll give you two answers, okay? I'm a big fan of enlightened self-interest, and I've been up against people like that before and tried to make change. And there are two answers I'll give you, and then the first one I'll break in half. The first thing is, if you're going to change the way classrooms are done and what's going on in the classroom so that you get teachers who are asking for it, don't go to the teachers. Do it in your classroom, and the students will go to the next class, and they'll say, oh, over in Miss Jones' class, they're doing that. How come we're not doing that there? That's the best way to get it going in the classroom. If you're dealing with an administration, look at if they're dealing with STEM and NCLB and all those other things. I have loads of friends that are being, you know, weighed down with the chains of those. Good, it's a good motive, but it's so restrictive and so harsh, and it's based on testing. Don't get me started. It stops a lot of learning. So here's what I do is I say, look, you can meet your standards, that's fine. But what's your utility bill on the computer lab? And how often is it open? And how many people are using it? And get some real numbers. And do return on investment, ROI, and TCO, total cost of ownership. And say, in 5 years, how much will this cost you and how much will it benefit our students? And then do the same thing with these guys or the laptops. And then show them, you can start on a small number and then maybe try it for a year or two and see if they're getting more engagement, more teacher involvement, more student involvement, what sort of comments are you getting from the parents? That's the best way, I think. But appeal to their enlightened self-interest, which is they can save money on it. And believe it or not, a lot of administrators, I've just been lucky, but a lot of administrators really do care about what happens in the classroom. And if you can demonstrate, you can make it defensible for them, I'm giving you all these guerrilla tactics. If you can make it defensible for them and give a benefit that actually makes a difference, they're going to go for it. That's been my experience. I hope it works for you.
I'd add one other thing that I know it at my public school, parents do a lot of the funding. I mean, they just have to because we have resources cut all the time, and they come back to the parents and say, in order to keep our library open, we need this kind of money right. from you, so please can you pitch in? So if you can make allies in the parents that are the ones who are helping to distribute this money, that's useful because, you know, if you can sit down and do a tech demo, and particularly if you can volunteer your time as a parent and say, I actually know how this stuff works, and I can come in and do that. I've been doing this with music in our school because I'm a musician. I can go to my classroom, my daughter's classroom teacher, and say, I can help you with this. And she's thrilled, you know, because I don't cost anything. But I can enhance that experience, and because she wants that in her classroom, but she can't afford it because they're not giving her the money. So try to convince the parent who's controlling some money and talk to the teachers, and if you can help out, they'd be more than happy to get your input.
Good point.
Good question. Question over here. We have about five more minutes.
Hi, Andrew Urbicheski from University of Michigan. I'm a professor in the college business there and teaching technology and love to use technology and things like that. And obviously being in the university environment is a little different than the K-12 environment in that students just expect to bring in technology and use whatever technology that they like. And my policy in the classroom has always been, you know, bring your notebooks, bring your laptops, use what you want. It's just right. if you're going to surf porn or play internet poker or sit in the back so you're not messing with anybody else. Until about 6 months ago, I read some research that was done at Cornell and was replicated at Rutgers and at Illinois State that was showing how students that were using technology in the classroom while a particular lecture was going on and then were tested afterwards, the ones that actually retained the most on the topic were the ones that weren't using technology. The ones that retained the yeah. second most were the ones that were surfing Facebook or something during it. And the ones that actually learned the least were the ones that were using Wikipedia or something to try to learn more about the topic. So my question then is, in your own experiences there in the classroom, is the technology actually helping the educational process in achieving our goals, or is it hindering it, or are we measuring incorrectly?
Really good question. Go to iTunes U whenever they have the camera behind the audience, and you can see what's on the kids' computers, the students' computers, and it's a lot of surfing. It's a lot of just wasted time. They're distracting themselves, but here's a better, more precise answer to your question is, the teacher is lecturing in the old style, not interacting. And if you're going to lecture, and you're going to have these kids up there engaged or disengaged, and they're going to go on Facebook, they're not going to pay attention. I think that the reason that the Wikipedia people did poorly was probably because they were focusing on that and not on the lecture. And maybe they're the type of people that are fact-driven instead of context-driven. When I was in college, the people we were most afraid of weren't the ones that wrote notes all the time. They were the ones that didn't take notes and were watching everything that went on, because you know that they had read the book ahead of time and they knew what was not in the book that was being covered. And that's what they wrote down. And that's my best advice for teachers all over is make sure your kids are reading the material before they come. My motto is over prepare and then relax. Because with the kids, if they're over prepared, they're going to be with you in the classroom. They're going to be engaged in your discussion. Then there's another part of this answer, and that is there's an app on here called Statistics One. You're a business teacher. There's an app in here called Statistics One, which is a textbook that was written only for the iPad. It was never intended to be printed. That's where textbooks may move, is not a printed book that was scanned and put in here, but an interactive experience that was designed for this. Does that make sense? I hope I answered the question. We good?
I'm sorry, you're pointing up there and saying, oh. Oh, Panasonic. Oh, I'm sorry, it's the plug time. And of course, I should do this. You see this monitor over here? I mean, that's probably a TV. You could, I don't even know if you could buy one, but we would like to thank Panasonic because it's enormous. And it looks really, 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 really good. And I'm sure within 5 years, you can have one of these in your house for a couple of $100. But in the meantime, we would very much like to thank Panasonic for lugging this enormous thing in here to project it here for your viewing pleasure. So thank you very much, Panasonic, by the way. I have one of your plasma displays. I love it. And that's the end of my plug-in, but it's true. I think we're done. So thank you very much for coming.
Thanks.